I'll be talking about basically some points from the history of Corona. I will tell the story how it came from 2009 to the current moment, how we got to where we got, and what we did along the way, what went right, and I would also like to talk about what did not go right. So it will be some kind of sandwich presentation with good and bad mixed with each other. It might be quite different presentation from the rest of in this track, in that I have no single line of code in the presentation. I have no single equation, but I have some crazy stuff. I have people calling us Hitler and so on. So first, I will quickly tell you what basically where Corona came from. So it all started in 2009 as a bachelor thesis. So here you can see the first images we I did with Corona. And the way I started was that I had to pick some topic for my bachelor thesis. And I wanted to do something web-based, some web tool. And I had a deal with a guy to be the advisor, and he would just stop talking to me. I don't know why, but he just stopped responding to my email. So there was the situation. I had about 1 week. I had to pick any topic or I would fail the university. So I was kind of desperate, and somebody suggested that I do rendering and ray tracer. And at first I thought, you know, no, this is crazy hard. It's like only for geniuses like Vlado. I was actually using V-Ray at the time. But a friend convinced me that it's actually possible. So I just sat down and started coding. And I actually saved the very first image that ever came from Corona. It's the one in the top left. And basically it's just the test that I was able to go over all the pixels in an image so that when I set the resolution, that the resolution is correct. So that's the one BMP from 2009 that was first image ever saved from Corona. The rest is in the top right. It's the first image with multiple objects. It was just spheres at the moment because those are much easier than triangles. And the bottom, that's first thing I would call art, with quotes. And it's some simple electron microscope shader that everybody does at some point. It was very popular in the 10 years ago. So this was the final product for the bachelor thesis. It was able to do geometry and point lights, and that was basically it. There was some reflection on the table, but there was no GI, there was no 3ds Max connection, nothing. But I was able to pass. It was actually originally named K-Ray, which was just how to name it, obviously, like something like V-Ray, so it was K-Ray after my last name. But then I actually found out that the name is actually taken. And one piece of advice, if you want to do ray tracer, every name is taken. Corona was actually like the 10th choice. I had 10 different names I went through, and I always Googled it, and there was always one renderer, you know, 3 years ago that was using the same name. So sorry, it was no Helios, no Solaris, it was Corona. But I actually liked the name. I got used to it. And after I did a bachelor thesis, I enjoyed working on it, so I actually continued. And I was doing masters, and I was able, the way I did the development was that I wanted to add something into Corona, and I would have to package it somehow to make it look like a school assignment. So when we had a class on statistics, I would do some measuring of the lens of the rays in the scene, and I was able to implement something inside Corona and do some measuring. And when we did optimization, I would of course optimize, you know, building of the structures in Corona. And I was actually able to pass Corona as 6 different assignments. Basically the same code, only just every time added something new into it and made it look like it's actually a math project or whatever. And at the end of 2011, I actually had the 3ds Max connection. And you could actually render something which would look like, you know, started resembling something reasonable, but still it was nowhere near production ready. So this is the first decent image from Corona. It was done by Ludwig Kotny. And the trick to this image is that it has more Photoshop than, you know, any woman on any cover of any magazine. It was just complete Photoshop, cover everything. You can actually see the mouse? No, you cannot see the mouse. So actually on the top of the walls you can see some artifacts, and the white walls are there actually because I couldn't render anything behind the windows. But it was on a track, so we made a goal to make it commercial because I wanted to continue with this, and the only way to continue would be to make money off it. So, and that's when I realized that to actually monetize it, to get some money, I would have to solve a lot of business problems, like start a company and set up e-commerce system, decide licensing, do marketing, etc., etc. And I wouldn't be able to do it alone. So I started a team. I had multiple offers from some random people who wanted to join the company, and they came to me and said, like, hey, I'm doing great money in selling natural gas and I want to expand into rendering. And I told them, sorry, I want somebody, you know, I can more related to the topic. So I decided to go with Adam, who was my longtime friend and who was the guy who gave me my first job. And with Jaroslav, who was my thesis advisor for PhD. I actually started doing PhD, but that went nowhere because this just started taking all my time. So we started a company in 2014, and we said, okay, in 6 months we will do the commercial release. And we basically quit our jobs, we took out all our saved money and just went for it. And this was when the real fun began. So first we did some planning. So this was our original Trello board. The good thing about this was that we didn't have to pay Trello. Bad part was that we couldn't go into the other room, or you know, we would have just random pieces of paper fall off. Then we, to be more efficient, we moved into my single room that I rented in an apartment. We set up our battle stations and just got to it. I was just coding, Adam was doing all the marketing and web and e-commerce stuff. And so Adam was sleeping in some pretty questionable conditions in the other room that had basically no lighting and no heat. We just got used to drinking Red Bull, so we had this small fridge which was just Red Bulls. Our diet changed quite a bit. So after some time, this was our breakfast. So it's instant oatmeal and some pills and some supplements and then coffee and then just go to coding. Bad thing is that we actually got some flu and we would just pass the same virus between us. So 1 week I was sick, the other week Adam was sick, and it was just all over and over again. And we lived like this. In the end, it took maybe 3 or 4 months longer because of course there were complications. But we finally did it. We did it in 2015. We did the commercial release on the 25th of February. It was done on this day because on the 1st of next month, the free version would expire. So we just couldn't postpone it anymore. It's like when they say software is never finished. Software is just allowed to escape into the world. And when we finally did it, we celebrated with this fancy meal from some Indian restaurant. We didn't have any table because, you know, non-computer table, so we just ate it like this. At this point, we didn't really care. It was just like, I don't care. I just care that we release it. We watch the statistics of the sales, and we just eat on the floor, and we are happy. So when the first money came, we immediately went to rent the office because we immediately wanted to hire more people and basically accelerate the development. Because until this point, it was just me and Jaroslav coding. So the first office, we hired it on budget, which showed in some places. Like, for example, if you buy a dual Xeon machine and you have an office like this and you came in the morning into the office and you would see just pool of water below the machine because the windows are leaking. That was kind of scary. And from the outside, it was even better. So you can guess which window it was. It was this one. We didn't mind, it was fun. It was like punk-driven development. It was kind of difficult to have people not run out of it when we did job interviews. They probably thought at first they were gonna get murdered or something. And we also celebrated with a cake, which became our tradition. So we actually had a custom-made cake delivered to the office, but of course we didn't have any utensils, so we just ate it on a big roll of insulation as a table, and we ate it with plastic knives because there was nothing else. But we actually managed to get more people into the team, and so this was our first team. And we always show this picture, and the alternate caption for this picture is basically, we are not paid to look cool. And from this was 2 years ago, and right now this is what we have. We have a way bigger team, and we have decent offices. This picture actually is not official, it's just from daily stand-up when I looked around the room and I found out that everybody came dressed in black, and there was just one guy dressed in red, so we decided to cosplay as a Corona logo. So you can see the color balance between the logo and between the team. So we are still expanding. We want to hire more people. It's kind of difficult right now with the job market and so on. So in case anybody of you wants to do some programming in Prague, just come talk to us. And we are looking for other ways, like how to code more efficiently, how to cooperate with Chaos Group better, and how to motivate people, and how to prevent data losses and corrupt files. And we are basically looking. We want to do what we do right now because we like it and we enjoy it. So we want to do it just on a bigger scale. So this is now. This is us now. And now I will look at the same thing from the perspective of the product. So you know, I will now pick some specific topics from Corona, which I think that went well. I mean, topics that Corona introduced to the ArcQuiz market. And then some other things where we had plans and they did not quite work so much. And as a disclaimer, I have to say that the second part, the part that did not go well, it's basically a roadmap for us. Because every single one of the things which did not go according to plan, we want to fix. So that's also what I will discuss. And we also have this thing where we save all the crazy feedback we get from people. So I also have some examples of crazy positive and crazy negative reactions. We have one huge wall in the office, and when somebody gets something crazy, we just print it and put it on the wall. So the first and most important thing we did was the no settings workflow. This is just the idea that you don't have to set anything in the renderer to get image in any scene. This is right now it's not that rare. I mean, a lot of renderers have it now, but I think Corona was the first one that actually, you know, made it really possible. Like not just promise it, but actually deliver it. And I think this was the key to our success. I never actually realized how much it bothered me to set up rendering parameters before I actually started using just Corona. And then after a few months, I had to switch to, I don't know what it was, maybe Mental Ray for something. And I would always set up all the parameters just automatically and not even think about this. And now for me, it was like, I had to set up 5 parameters and it was the end of the world. I did not want to do it at all. And I just realized how much I got used to this idea. So right now everybody has it, even V-Ray has it too, since maybe 2 or 3 versions. But I really think we showed the way here. And this has also some disadvantages. And one of the disadvantages is that if we really want to present Corona as a no setting renderer, then we cannot do optimizations that require settings. So we actually have some ways to make Corona faster, maybe 2 times faster in some scenes, just by changing some values. But these values, they are hidden in Corona, and we don't tell anybody what they are or where they are, because you would be able to get 2 times faster rendering just by tweaking few parameters. But then it would just became ingrained in people's minds that you have to change settings before you actually start to work. So So we actually prefer for Corona to have this speed rather than have Corona faster by some unknown factor and have all these universal settings and standard workflow and six-part tutorials on how to set up all the spinners and so on. So, and now where it actually failed. So the same approach we try to use for displacement, which is a way to modify geometry by subdividing it into super fine triangles and then just moving them. And the tricky part about this is the super fine. So you have to create millions of polygons to get any reasonable level of detail. So we thought that if we just try to do it and optimize it, it would just work. Because in other renderers like V-Ray, there's this switch between 2D and 3D displacement, and there's like subdivision rate and adaptivity rate parameters like this. And we thought, okay, we will not do any of these kinds of parameters. We will just try to optimize it and just brute force it. Just take the hit and hope that people will think this is okay. And they didn't think this was okay. So we did second version and it was much faster and people still didn't think it was okay. And then we wanted to do it once again, just do the third optimization. And then the guy who did the second optimization quit the company because he went to work for some game development. And this was in the beginning. So we did not have really any quality procedures for the code because, in the beginning you just assume everybody just works exactly like you. So you don't need to tell them, you need to comment your code or you need to be reasonable. So we found out that the second version was super complex and there was not a single line of comment. So we were stuck with a huge pile of code that works in some way, but improving it would mean to understand it. And it stayed there basically untouched for the next 1 or 2 years. So this is one of the hard lessons that I guess anybody has to learn when they go into software development. So now we have some different procedures and it actually takes longer now to implement any specific feature because we have all the checks in place. So it might seem like the development of Corona is going slower, but in reality what happens is that we make sure this situation never happens again. Make sure that when one guy writes a code, then everybody else can read it and understand it. So we will probably have to implement to drop the idea of no settings displacement, and we will probably have to do something big like the 2D displacement mode, which would lead to additional switch. But even before we do that, I still think there is one shot at doing it automatically. So something will happen for the Corona version 3. It will not happen for Corona version 2, but for Corona version 3, it's one of the eight essential features, which means that either Corona version 3 will have better displacement or there will just be no Corona version 3. It just doesn't officially come out unless there's way improved displacement. So now another of the big wins for us. And this is, by the way, one of my favorite images. It's some class where they are teaching girls at high school to do 3D. And they wanted licenses of Corona for free. And they wanted them fast. So they send us, made the signs and send us this email describing what they do. So this is the way to get free licenses. And we were super happy to provide them. So the second biggest topic for us is the interactive rendering, which is just that you open your 3D application, you replace one of the viewports with the rendered results, and you do this at the beginning when you create a new scene, and then after 2 hours or however long it takes, when you have the scene finished, you can either save this small image or you just render the same thing in bigger resolution and that's it. That's our ultimate goal. We're able to make this work with some hiccups here and there. It's mostly caused by some problems in 3ds Max, because we had to break a lot of rules in 3ds Max to make this happen. Like there's a rule that you should not use multiple threads in 3ds Max basically ever. And we decided to do it. It was crashing a lot, then it was crashing less. Now it's not crashing at all. But it took us 3 months to do, to figure out. And we have to do a lot of crazy hacks that I will not scare you with. And even in spite of these hiccups, people still like this. And again, other renderers followed, but we were really breaking the ground here with this approach. And one of the biggest technical problems, or maybe the biggest single technical problem in this, is how to do it so you have only one code base. So you can say that the interactive rendering and the final rendering is the same thing. Because every time this was attempted before, it would lead into having something like mental array and iRay, or vRay and vRayRT, or I don't know, all the other renderers. So it would always be two different renderers. And we wanted to have just single code base, because that means half the work. And it also means that the images are always the same, and it has the same features. And we found out basically the only way to do this is to have just the interactive rendering. So in Corona, there is only interactive rendering. There is no offline rendering. So if you just press F9 and do offline rendering, what you are actually seeing is the interactive rendering will get initialized, and you will have the full interactive rendering running in the background. It's just that it won't update when you move the mouse. It just has the updates disabled and discarded, but it's exactly the same thing. And okay, so there's the Hitler guy. We banned this guy on the forum, and he got basically for about 1 or 2 months, each day he would register a new account and just find new creative ways to post about us on Facebook and so on. And the thing he didn't like is that Corona was taking too much RAM. So where we have some reserves is implementing Corona into more applications. So right now we have 11 developers, and we are selling the plugin for 3ds Max. So we have production ready plugin for 3ds Max. And we have the cinema version in beta stage. So we have 11 developers and two commercial plugins. And I always look at the websites of the different renderers, because same as Vlado, it's my job to know the competition. And I sometimes see these two numbers reverse. It's like two developers and 11 plugins. And I always think, how is it even possible? Because for us, right now with the cinema integration, we have 4 people working on it. And we just the API for the cinema is so complex that if you want to support everything, we had to dedicate more developers to this than to the entire problem of light transport, of actually doing the actual rendering in the Corona core. So this is also something that where Chaos Group helped us a lot, because they basically went through the same obstacles as we before, and we can actually learn from how do I do distributed rendering in 3ds Max, or how do I do proxies in Cinema 4D. So I'm hoping this will get better. That we are actually planning to release the cinema version by the end of the year. And we are doing some other interesting stuff, like Adam showed at the keynote. So we have the ARCHICAD integration, which looks impressive, but also there's still a lot of work to do. So this is actually the first render by user from ForestPack. It was the first daily build that supported ForestPack. And the third biggest topic for us is the light mix. So what is light mix? It's a way to change the intensities of lights after you start rendering. So the 4 images you see, they were rendered at the same time. And it wasn't like you would set up 4 different scenarios and then hit render. You would just render your scene, and then you would change the intensity. So if you decrease the intensity of the environment, you get the night shot. If you increase it, you get the noon shot, and so on. And you can basically just freely play with it, just try what works and what doesn't. And users just love it. This was the second biggest feature we did after interactive rendering. And it was actually done in one weekend. So making the final image is just adding some buffers which you have in memory, just with different coefficients. So this is super simple. But the tricky part is during the rendering, you need to somehow, for each light value, you need to split it into buffers for different lights. And how to do this so it's fast and reliable, and it works everywhere in the ray tracing core, which is the most complex part of any renderer. This was the part we were not able to crack for a long time. So I would be just thinking about it and thinking, you know, no, this is impossible. This cannot be done. And then I had a breakthrough on one Friday evening. So I basically canceled my weekend plans, which was easy when you have no life, when you are a developer. And I just did it over one weekend. Of course, we had to finish the UI and do some scripts that will set it up for you and so on. But the important part, it was done just in just 2 days. And this is a single thing that basically this is the only feature you can spot in our revenue graphs. Like you can point, okay, so it goes up from this point because we added light mix. And now again for something that didn't work. So actually this image is quite funny to me. It was created after we announced the Chaos Group merger. So we had the version 1.7 at the time, and people were saying like, okay, so 1.7 is the last cool version and 1.8 will be complete shit because you know, they sold out. So we solved this problem by switching version 1.8. The next version will be actually called version 2. So the problem is number of settings. So as I said in the beginning, you don't need to change anything to get the image. But Corona still has settings. And these are not settings like number of rays and number of subdivisions and adaptivity thresholds. These are settings like, do you want to render just picked objects, or do you want to globally multiply light intensity, or do you want to add bokeh effects, and do you want to load some custom maps into background and so on. These are options that actually make your life easier, like for example the light mix setup. But these are still options. It's something you have in the render dialog, and we try to keep the render dialog small, but it just grows bigger. And you can actually measure this, you know, apparent complexity. It's not the real complexity, it's just apparent complexity of renderer. You can measure it in centimeters. You can open all the render dialogs and you can just measure, you know, how long is the line. So here is a comparison between Corona, some of the alpha versions, and the latest stable version. And you can see, you know, even though it got more simple actually, because it's bug-free and faster, the apparent complexity measured in centimeters just increased. And even though it's stuff like denoising and light mix. So, and then we have people who, in the beginning, people would come to Corona and say, okay, this looks super easy. And now they come to Corona and look at it and say, okay, this looks, there is a lot of settings, so what's the point of using it over, you know, mental ray or V-ray? So this is something we are struggling with. So sometimes when we add the new features, we don't add everything we think would be useful just because it would add centimeters to the dialogue. And I think this is one of the biggest problems for the idea of having single renderer for ArcVis and VFX. Because you just can't hide your additional settings so it doesn't look like it's more difficult. So this is also one of my favorite images after the merge. So people got angry, and when people get angry, they get creative. So I really enjoyed the Photoshops that were created. So denoising. Denoising is the exception to the rule that we keep Corona simple at the cost of performance. So we are playing with denoising for maybe since 2015, about 2015. It actually took us more than a year to develop into usable solution. And we were the first render on the market to have integrated denoiser. Yay. It was 2 weeks before V-Ray. We beaten V-Ray by 2 weeks, so it was completely insignificant, but you know, that's not what history will show. So, and denoiser, you have to set it up. You have to click something before you start the render, because it has to store a lot of additional data. So this was breaking of the rule that we don't add stuff that makes it faster, but also complex. And the reason why we broke the rule was basically because it makes the rendering 4 times faster. And when you have the option to cut your render time from 2 hours into 1/2 hour, you do it. And I was actually skeptical if people would actually accept this into their workflows, and they did. We got some great responses for this, and nobody minded, you know, setting it up before the render when they saw what it can do. And so our denoiser solution is it's housemade. It was developed by us exclusively. And of course, you know, there's the NVIDIA denoiser. So these are actually 2 different denoisers. Like ours is focused on the quality. So you can denoise and then show the image to the client. And the NVIDIA solution is, of course, more based towards real time. So it actually makes sense to use both. So one of the projects for internship over the summer is to actually use the NVIDIA denoiser, plug it into our interactive rendering, and just see what happens. And I'm really looking forward to this. So hopefully Corona version 3. And yeah, this is the same guy as the Hitler guy. And it was the same topic, just a different day. And the next problem is basically what Vlado covered already. And he covered it way better, so I will not spend too much time on it. But in case you didn't guess in Vlado's presentation, the one renderer with the really, really weird black spot on the ball, that was actually Corona. And if you have read the Bible, the PBRT, I can explain to you why it happens. But in the beginning, it was quite surprising for us too. And so far, every attempt to remove this bug just created another bug. So now we have like list of possible configurations, and it's either you have this black spot, or you have some glass looks different when you look at glass through mirror. And it's just like balancing different fakes, and it always creates some problems just in different places. And we try to hide the problem into different place, and then it's fine for a week. Then one guy finds the new problem, and after the one guy found it, then everybody found it for some reason. I don't know why. So this is something that we actually had a brainstorming session with Vlado yesterday, and we want to fix it. It's just this is definitely not easy. This is like you have to start from the very beginning of what it means to have reflective material, and what is the user say when they say we want something that doesn't cast shadows, because there are like 3 different interpretations of what that means. And we were of course battling some 3ds Max limitations, but this is not the doesn't have any visual examples, so I'll just skip it. And okay, so this is the reaction to the denoiser actually. And it was on Skype, so it was again, I did not censor it, so like NVIDIA did, so hopefully it's fine. And the last thing, which was also pioneered by Corona, is to basically remove the irradiance caching, to create a new workflow where you use caching, but you use caching only for secondary arrays. So when I started doing Corona, of course I did irradiance caching because V-Ray did irradiance caching, and that was my big, big mantra, big target that I wanted to achieve. And also because Jaroslav wrote a book on irradiance caching some 10 years ago. So this was the thing to do. If you do rendering and you want to have it cool, you do irradiance caching. And then I found some scene where it didn't work. So this one is obviously quite ridiculous. It was some bug, but you would see similar artifacts in different scenes. And it was similar to the fake thing. You would just fix it in one place, and then in different place it would be broken. And you would fix it for 1 week, and after 1 week somebody would do some crazy geometry setup and it wouldn't work. And as I was fixing more and more of these edge cases, it got slower and slower. And in the end, it was just faster to just disable the irradiance caching and use the caching for the secondary arrays. So when some light is traveling from light to camera, it may bounce 10 times in the scene. And what actually makes sense is to cache the 9 bounces after the first one. Just let the first bounce ray trace or path trace that will just make everything super, super clean and super crisp. And then you can just cache. And this is basically the sweet spot between the artifacts and artifacts and fast rendering, and no artifacts and super slow rendering. So again, we are not right now we are not the only renderer who does this, but we are one of the first ones that actually experimented with this. And this is not our invention. This was actually invented by users. They came to us and say, "Hey, delete the irradiance caching. It's better when you do it." And the last problem. Okay, again we have some fanboys. I have to say I don't like these fanboys. Like I don't like Corona fanboys. I don't like when people say, "Hey, I love Corona and everything else is bad." I don't like it. This is please be respectful to other developers and other renderers. So the last thing is the one that I think we are the most innocent in, and that's the whole thing about memory usage. So in the beginning, I didn't know how to illustrate this, and in the end, this is really the best illustration from all the cases. This is just the graph of price of 8 gigabytes of memory. So at some point it went so low that people would tell us, we don't care about RAM at all. We can buy 128 gigabytes. Just make Corona as fast as possible. We don't care about memory. So we did it because in the rendering there is a lot of trade-offs between speed and memory usage. So for example, when you have triangles, you can cache the geometry normal of a triangle, and that's 12 bytes per triangle, but you don't have to compute it every time you do ray tracing. So you have this option, like make the ray tracing 3% faster, or make it 12 bytes less memory per polygon. So of course we went for the faster option, and we did it over and over and over again in multiple places. And then the prices started rising and we got to the crap point. And now we are doing the opposite thing. We are now trying to find places how to lower the usage of memory in Corona. So actually on the plane here and in the evening on the hotel, I was actually finishing some optimization to have it ready in time for Corona version 2 that removes some really ugly hack and lowers the memory usage by 10 to 15%. So this cannot be also done overnight, but we know about this problem and we are working on it. The ugly part about this is that it takes time, and it's time. We wanted to do caustics at this point, and instead of caustics, we are just doing memory optimization, because you have to think of the ecosystem, and the ecosystem is telling you memory is now expensive.